All right, y'all, let's talk. You saw the title of this video. I don't have to spell this out. A month ago, a man named George Floyd was brutally murdered by the hands of the police. This sparked what right now feels like an entire movement for the demand of change that is needed for America to finally recognize what has continued even after the abolishment of segregation, even after the abolishment of slavery. Hell, since the beginning of slavery. It's been over four centuries, and the needle has only moved a few inches, and we still have a long way to go to have true equality. This could be another chance to move that needle ever so slightly for the better. The battle against systemic oppression is on the forefront of this country. So I wanted to pitch in some sort of way. After all, I am black, and I am proud to be black. I want to use this platform to help benefit that cause. And what better way to do that than talk about the way racism is being discussed within cartoons? This will be a bit of a mini-series where we take a closer look at many episodes that take on racial discrimination, getting an opportunity to see if each episode is taking on the issue properly, or laid an egg in trying to do so. We start off with one common episode that a lot of people share when things like this occur. So, let's talk about racism and Static Shock. The episode starts off in the mall at a food court as the Metabreed, Ebon, Talon, and Shiv come about to harass the citizens. That's when Static came in to take care of business. They were able to capture Talon and hold her into custody. The battle itself is not too much to brag about in the opening sequence. A lot of kids' WB shows don't outright show the violence necessarily. A lot of quick flashes are being used with each blow that happens to the opponent. So there isn't too much to talk about when it comes to the animation in this scene. Except for Grandma. We need more grandmas like this. We then cut into Virgil's household as the fam watches the news about Static's heroic bout. We see Rich really chilling out at the home, and Sharon gets a bit fed up with Rich. So when we get into Virgil's room, we see Rich trying to come up with new slogans for Static. He notices that Virgil isn't paying attention to him as he's deep in thought. When he wonders what's up with Virgil, he goes on to say,
"My sister's right. I hate that."
"Right about what?"
"We never hang at your crib. We always hang here. Face it, bro. You've never invited me over. I've never even met your pops."
So we see Virgil get a bit angsty over the idea of having Virgil over. But with the persistence of Virgil being strong, he didn't have much of a choice in the matter. So they planned to hang out at Richie's place later in the week. I honestly enjoyed how they set up this portion of the exposition. Unlike a lot of shows, Static Shock tends to have slower pacing. The way Richie was hesitant in answering Virgil is very telling that there is a bigger reason why he would prefer hanging at Virgil's place. Considering that Richie felt like this is a much bigger deal compared to Virgil, with a stuttering in his voice, and asking why Virgil is sweating over this are subtle hints that Virgil may not feel very welcomed if he came to Richie's house, and we'll know why soon. We cut to an abandoned building, where we see Ebon showing his frustrations about losing Talon and wants to get his revenge on Static. After that small scene, we cut over to Richie's place, who has a large collection of action figures in his room. Virgil seems to be enjoying his time there, and Richie seems a bit relieved about the situation with his father not being home for tonight.
"Boys, dinner in 10 minutes.
Smells good, Mrs. F.
Thank you, Virgil. There's your father. I'd better go talk to him.
I thought he was on the night shift.
It got changed."
Of course it did. I think they did a solid job with a large sense of tension between Richie and his mom, how they both kind of spoke quietly so Richie's father wouldn't hear. I also want to bring up the sound effect of the door slamming. It felt incredibly chilling to me. The slam shifted the tone very quickly, giving us no visual of what the father looks like. That sense of power over the household really gets to you. So, Virgil, not getting the hints, was ready to meet with Richie's pops.
"Hey, Mr. Foley. Good to finally meet you."
"Hey, Dad. This is my friend Virgil. Remember, I told you about him."
"Not nearly enough."
Yikes. So we transition to the dinner table, and I want you to see how they set this up. Silence. Silverware scraping the plate as people are eating, and a very depressing atmosphere in the opening segment. The tension and awkwardness between everyone really gives you that sense of uncomfortability. Virgil, like what a lot of us do, can sense how the tension has risen within someone. So he tried to break the ice by asking if Richie wants to listen to a new rap album.
There will be no rap played in this house. That music teaches kids to disrespect their parents.
Some rap is positive, Mr. Foley.
It's all garbage. It tells kids to write on walls, stay out past curfews, and heaven knows what else. It tears down everything guys like me built. Look around you. Dakota's gone to pot. Well, not in my house.
All right. So not sugarcoating this. Everyone, meet your racist. Blatantly calling an entire rap genre a bad influence and teaches nothing but extremely bad habits. Even claiming that it tears down what guys like him built. The hard-working, middle-class white man. While at this time, African Americans struggled to get a well-paying job with the amount of prejudice within the hiring process against black individuals that makes it damn near impossible to show they could do the same amount of work. Even if they do get that, they would get paid less compared to someone who is white for the same job and will have to bend over backwards to even get a raise. Hell, even asking for one could result in risking losing your job altogether because it would seem incredibly ungrateful. But go ahead, pop off on the fact that you built this country. Going back to rap, a majority of rap music is made by black men. Considering around this time, a lot of popular music that had videos dedicated to them had a lot of mature themes. But even then, like what Virgil said, that music is only the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the artistry of rap. The embodiment of telling someone's life story has been used at a constant, and it gave an opening for fans to understand how they became who they are at that time. Heck, it could even be seen as a reflection of some sorts, and the language that comes from rap can be beautiful, something that this dude will never understand. So we cut to Richie's room once again, and he is completely stressed out about how his father is acting. Virgil tries to calm him down, trying to mask the reality of the situation to make it about being more of a boomer situation than a racial one. When he goes to brush his teeth, however, well, he overhears this conversation.
And now I see why Richie acts like a hood, Maggie. That kid's a bad influence. All his kind are.
Keep your voice down.
It's bad enough I gotta deal with them all day long. Now one of them's in my house.
We then see Virgil getting the heck out of there. Richie tries to get him to stay to talk this out, but Virgil knew he overstayed his welcome. As soon as Richie's father came out to know what was going on, Richie lashed out at him.
Well, you got what you wanted, Dad. My best friend's gone because of you and your stupid racism. I hate you!
This is a lot to take in from an episode like this. They wanted to take on this issue head first. With the dinner table and what Virgil overheard were prime examples of what it's like being in a situation like that. As a viewer, I genuinely feel bad for Virgil because he desperately did not want that reality to be true. After all, this is the father of his best friend, someone he considers to be close with. After overhearing that blatant hatred this man has over him and those that are like him, he made the right decision. First off, there's no point in trying to change the heart of someone like that if you are a young black man, especially if it's in their own house. Because if it does get heated, you'll be arrested and charges will be pressed without a doubt. I also want to point out the use of language within these scenes, specifically black and white thing and racism. I really like that these terms are being used because it gives the opportunity to have a real discussion on these topics for kids with other family members and friends. It is so rare that we get to see shows use very raw terms because of the heavy history they bring. And in all honesty, it's the kind of conversation that needs to be had as early as possible, no matter who you are. We head to the next day and go to Virgil's home as he is deep in his own thoughts. That's when we see his father come in to see if he was okay. He did express his disbelief that Richie's dad can be so hateful towards a black man.
That kind of hate feeds on itself.
And that is very true. He does express the pride that he has for Richie breaking away from that way of thinking. He knows that it's important for Virgil to be by Richie's side because of the increased rift between the two. When Virgil's dad left, the phone began to ring and it was Richie's mom. We found out that Richie had ran away from home after she asked Virgil if Richie spent the night there. We see Virgil's dad seem more upset as he walks away as the two were talking. This is a great way to really express the realities of racism and how it affects so many people. Virgil's dad brought up many good points about those who have horrible ideals when it comes to people of color. The hatred is deeply, deeply rooted in their family trees that it can be very difficult to not share those points of views if you don't look for that understanding yourself and just listen to those family members. Not only that, the environment can play a large role in that as well. If you grow up in a predominantly white neighborhood, there's a good chance you may never witness the experience a person of color has to deal with in person and see how different the interaction is. Staying in that bubble will lead you into believing that everyone should look, sound, and behave to that standard, which could cause people to believe that someone who looks and sounds different to be more alien. We then cut to Richie walking into the blistery storm. He then dealt with an encounter with two mutant goons and was able to escape them. After that, we see Mr. Foley in Mr. Hopkins' office. Foley is accusing Virgil of lying about Richie's whereabouts. Even though Hopkins told him he wouldn't lie about Richie's location, Foley still persisted in the lack of trust by saying,
"And you trust him knowing how thick they are?"
And Hopkins clapped back, accusing Foley for not trusting his own son. Even though Foley was being completely disrespectful, Hopkins was ready to help in the search for Richie. This scene once again shows the amount of ignorance Foley really has. As we saw in an earlier scene, Foley makes it clear he doesn't want to believe anything a black person says. The fact that he's accusing Virgil of lying in front of his own father, going so far by saying, "and you trust him knowing how thick they are," clearly talking down to black people like they're inferior to someone who is a black man. That to me shows how Foley refuses to see how his words affect others, especially to those who are black. The lack of willingness to look past his racism and continue to put the blame on everyone except himself and lash out on black people who are trying to help. Hopkins was used very well because he sees through Foley's crap and made sure he gets to the point in what Foley believes, finishing his sentence about how Richie didn't tell Foley about Virgil and his dad being black, blatantly saying Foley will need his help whether he likes it or not, because Foley isn't involved in Richie's life like Virgil and Hopkins are. We cut over to Static looking for Richie, trying to use a walkie-talkie to try and communicate with him. When Richie finally picks up, Static expresses the amount of worry he has over Richie. After Richie expressed his frustrations with his father and how his words may have costed Richie his best friend, Static reassured him that the two went through way too much together for that to affect their relationship. During this conversation, we see that Ebon was eavesdropping on the two as he finds out that Richie is considered a close friend to Static. So as soon as the opportunity is right, he captures him. This was a somewhat wholesome scene. We can understand where Richie is coming from. I mean, his father's words chased out his closest friend. The amount of bigotry in that household can be a lot for someone who doesn't agree with that way of thinking, especially when it's a family member who is the man of the household and can kick you out at any time for any reason. So after lashing out at his father, getting out of there as soon as possible will be the best for his sake because he is set that his father would never understand the friendships he makes. Also, I think him deciding not to go to Virgil's place makes sense as well because he knows that his family will go straight there to confront the Hawkins family whether or not they knew of his whereabouts. Which isn't too far from the truth since Foley barged into Hawkins' office earlier in this episode. Well, there's not really much to discuss on the kidnapping, it's just something to help the plot move along. We then cut over to the dads checking out a makeshift homeless shelter, where a lot of runaway youth resides for the time being until they figure something out. What's interesting about this place is that it is mostly people of color that reside here, which is a place that Foley will quickly look down upon, even calling them pigs. Pretty ironic considering how that term is used now. Hawkins emphasized how these kids have gotten here due to not seeing eye to eye with their parents to the point where they have to leave, similar to what we see with Hawkins and his son. Before they leave, the kid who was looked down upon by Foley told them that there was a new location they can go to. We quickly find out that that location was some sort of mysterious trap. We then cut over to the Metabred hideout once again. Ebon is ready to question Richie on how to contact Static so that he can make a trade to get Talon back. Richie plays hard to get and prepares to let Static know that he is in danger and where his location is discreetly.
You heard me, Ebon. If you're so big and bad, why do you live in the musty old Ferris Row projects, huh?
Ferris Row, North Side. Place was condemned when it was new.
Yeah, that was super discreet. So after Static received the message after saving the last person from a burning building, he was quick to go after him. Of course, an episode that focuses on a heavy topic like this so much can escape some sort of criticism. The villains are not that bright in the slightest and don't seem very threatening to me. Ebon, who is supposed to be the most intimidating figure out of the group, comes off as some dude who's known to just be angry. That's it. While Shiv is just your stereotypical jokester henchman, heck, even Talon doesn't seem very interesting in the slightest. While it should be in the back burner, the villains don't do anything more than just move the plot along. We then see Hawkins and Foley barge into the building they were being led to. We continue to hear Foley complain about how ungrateful Richie is, giving him what he thinks is everything he could ask for. Then Hawkins finally had enough.
Richie wasn't the only boy who ran away from you last night.
What your son heard, Hawkins. I wasn't talking about him.
No, you were talking about his kind, that's all. Well, I know your kind, Foley. I've seen your kind all my life. A fine, upstanding bigot. His nose so close to the grindstone, he can't see anything else. Meanwhile, the world changes and grows, and he's blind to it. Ignorant. And proud of that, too. And you know the worst part? You've got a terrific son. One of the best and brightest around. And because of the way you are, you'll never really know him. Richie ran away from you a long time ago, Foley. And who can blame him?
Facts. Just straight up facts. It's more than just about what Foley said. It's about that man's real problem of facing the reality that the world is becoming more and more progressive. And the amount of hatred will make everyone leave them behind. That's especially the case with Richie. Richie had the opportunity to be involved within the black community, and meeting Virgil really showed him that black people aren't what his father makes them out to be. With those experiences, his viewpoint is extremely different compared to his own father. With their points of views being so polar opposite, he had no choice but to be as distant and away from your home as long as you can. He made sure to keep his father out of his life away from home, because he knows that as soon as he finds out about who he hangs out with, Foley will do everything in his power to never let him see them again, which isn't fair at all. Richie knows that it's extremely unlikely that his father will ever change his views. Hawkins being blunt with that reality needed to happen because of the nonsense he continues to spew about those being ungrateful to him and what he has done. Foley didn't even realize who he was talking to, the father of the black kid you chased off with your words, starting off with saying Richie wasn't the only one who ran away from you last night could put anyone off guard. As a parent, Hawkins really didn't have any empathy towards how Foley feels because of how he affected Virgil. It's not something only Virgil has dealt with. Hawkins dealt with it himself as well as many, many more black people. Letting Foley know that he reads him like a book is the fastest way to shut him up, and praising Richie of finally being the one to see past those views compared to his father puts a stamp on how low Foley actually is. We then cut back over to Richie continuing to drone on Ebon's hideout. That's when Ebon realized what Richie is actually doing and found the communicator he was using. As soon as Ebon was ready to hurt Richie, the dads came in because coincidence. We get a huge battle between the dads and the villains. When the dads were in a corner, Static came along for the save and took out both Shiv and Ebon. Once they were defeated, Richie went over to his dad to make sure he was okay. The two hugged it out and Foley finally apologized for what he has done to drift his son away. I don't really have too much to say on the action alone. What I said about the battle at the mall is similar to the battle here. I think the main talking point is the apology Foley made. I think it did feel a bit forced, but overall it was nice. I think the main thing was the delivery of the line before the apology. I think at this point, the actor didn't really do much to make it seem he broke a sweat or have a sense of relief. So it took away from the apology to sound genuine to the level that it should be. Though, Richie picks up the slack to make it a nice touching moment. We then go back to the center, where we see Virgil cleaning up the court. We then see Richie and Foley come in to get Virgil so they can all go to Comic-Con. As Foley talks about his curiosity about the event, Richie didn't want to spoil anything for him with how the event was like. And that was the Sons of Our Fathers. Being real here, the final scene is lackluster at best. It's good to know that everything is now cool with Virgil and Foley, but I'll be honest, it would have been nice if we saw Foley have that talk with Virgil as well. But I can understand not to fill the ending with an apology fest. Overall, this was a solid attempt on the topic of racial discrimination. While the villains took a serious backseat to this particular episode, it's obviously within good reason. They were not shy when confronting racism. The dinner scene and the hallway scene showed how intense and uncomfortable being in a racist household can be. Hawkins' role was used perfectly in being a man to straight up tell it like it is. The relevancy is still very strong to the times today, and it's a great episode to view and be a major starting point in why what's happening today is happening. Thank you for taking the time to see this review. I wanted to do something a little bit different. I want to take the time for you all to donate to various causes to support the lives of people of color. I want to start things off locally. So the first fundraiser is the Advance the Lives of the Black Community. This fundraiser is led by the Atlanta Falcons quarterback Matt Ryan, whose goal is to raise $2 million to be used by a variety of black communities in need around the metro Atlanta area. The link to the fundraiser will be in the description. Thank you for the Patreons of July. Until then, good afternoon, good evening, and good night.